See, our main spot in East Oakland was on East 14th, across street to Bowling Alley's over here. The Black Panther headquarters is right there. And right in back of it over here is our main distribution center. If you look at the old pictures, people will remember Johnny Gunn and all of them. They went to Sacramento. When you see the Panthers going to Sacramento with guns, so half of our organization was ex, you know, the whole East. Well, anyway, so we were blacker than the Panthers. Plus, we helped the movement. We helped the movement. That's why when I left, why would I go to Algeria instead of Monte Carlo somewhere? What gangster's gonna run right into Revolutionary headquarters? Unless that's where their mind is. All of our vision came from basically the white man, yes. He had a mafia, nationwide organization. We should have one too. Why? If white folks have one, why should they have one and we don't have one? It's just capitalist thinking. Everything was fine till the white man realized, just a minute. Remember, the white man is the one turning me out to drugs. My friends was working for the white man because they wanted to divert me, the innocent, just like what we're doing now, as innocent as it could be. It don't, you think it looks innocent to them? Heck no! They spitting and pooping and everything, man, about what we do here. The most harmless, they're talking about harm in America physically, is here. We wouldn't do it if they rigged up something, you just push a button and blow up a lot of, nobody here would do that. No, we don't do that. That's what they looked at, working out, lifting weights, working on a job, saving your money, not getting high. That is a danger. That's a potential black power leader. That's why they did it. They turned me out. Now when the people hear this, they go all know. Everybody in Oakland go, oh yeah, GC. They know who that is, J.L. Lee. They all know who that is. You know, and all of this comes, it's been a long, this is a 50-year project that's been going on. So, their purpose was to divert us from participating in the struggle, right? This is what happened. The problem came when, see, inside of Oakland, everybody talked about us. The in crowd. Outside of Oakland, they talk about the Black Panthers. I'm sorry. Huey Newton then was not the most popular people in town. All the slick, the big Negroes were. Ward Brothers, Magones, all the people, those was, everybody talked about us. The whole, we were the heroes. Now, two things went wrong for the white man. Number one, they wanted to turn us against the rebellion, and then they wanted to divert us from rebellion. But we had so much confrontation and so much challenge with the system and lasted so long that we became more popular than the rebellion. Plus we had money and plus everybody knew the structure, because they saw it happen. That's why East Oakland became Felix Mitchell, all the big time guys, you know, if you read about, they came right out of East Oakland mostly. Why? Because everybody, in the early years, people, oh, they might smoke all the weed in town, but Jesus don't like that drug dealing. You know, that's the way East Oakland was. Everybody was more Christian orientated, and even the people smoking weed, that it was something wrong with it being a big super business. But after it lasted so long, everybody saw how it was going, everybody got turned out. The other thing with the police brutality, with all the stuff they did to us, and we survived. When I say us, I mean to me, because I'm the target of it. We lasted so long that the people saw that the white man wasn't as bad as he was, because look at Big Hank. And they would tell him, you beat us up, but Big Hank, da, 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 da. And I remember, we have East Oakland Enterprises. We have singers, I have three record shops, you know, all throughout East Oakland, you know, 85th down 47th, 23rd, that covers, you know, most of East Oakland. And dope houses that go along with that. You know what I mean? And each and every, from Funk Town all the way to Sobranie Park. You know what I mean? And every set that later on became separate, you know what I mean? This is Funk Town here, this is 23rd, this is, you know. But in those days, the whole thing, we was good with everybody in every set, and every set collaborated and cooperated with us. The only difference between us and the big Negroes, it's the same thing today. Our brothers, and I'm telling you, this is the only mistake that y'all made. We were all very similar, except y'all accepted the white man's authority. This is the only problem. This is your main problem. Therefore, when you got your life was, I want to avoid the white man. When the white man puts you on the board, the chessboard, you're finished. Y'all accepted that. I didn't accept it. Never did. And all the time they thought they was going to get rid of me, I had in my mind this one thing. You'll never drag me behind your chariot down the street in front of everybody and they'll say, there's your hero. Why? Because it's what they did to everybody else. In other words, we'd studied enough of history to say, no, 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 boss man. That's why when they thought they was getting ready to spring it, after the second assassination attempt, and y'all will remember this, remember the first one on 82nd Avenue in Bancroft? Yeah, it's about 1970, this final solution is kicking in. So the police arrest, they snatch me up out of my car, and doors is open and all kind of stuff. And they take me around the corner, remember Arroyo Park there. Now they leave this car with the doors wide open, sunroof back and everything. And everybody knows whose ride that is, right? There's a big H right there. You can see that H from back there where you are. There's a big H on the hood. Hey, that's bad. That's bad, boy. This is an expensive car. It was nice. Okay, it's got mink in it. It's got a telephone, 11 channels, YR84808, something like that. I can remember it now. 11 channels. I could call all over the world on that boy. Yeah. People had phones in their cars, but they were just phony phones. Just like the niggas used to have TV antennas.
Rabbit ears.
They didn't have no TV in there. They just had rabbit ears.
You'd just be hanging on the...
Hanging, it's pitiful. I didn't do that stuff. No siree. Everything was hooked up and worked. It was expensive. So, the main mistake, y'all accepted the white man's authority. When the white man say it's it, everybody say, well, fold up and go on off to prison. Because they accept it as authority. I didn't accept, it's the only difference. Now, what happened was this. Since y'all accepted his authority, you didn't fight the white man. It's just like pulling yourself out of the game. Well, suppose we stay in the game and we keep fighting. What's going to happen? We're going to get better. We're going to improve. And pretty soon, you won't even understand where we're at. That's where we are now. Y'all don't understand where we're at. And before I finish today, I'm going to tell you where we are so you'll understand what we're doing, because I don't want to come out there anymore and look at y'all and you got that sad look on your face like the poor brother, they gonna do this. Yeah, they probably will. We getting ready to open up and do all kind of stuff. And we don't have the power yet to stop them from doing what they do. We don't care what they do. They've been doing it up to now, and here we are, good God Almighty. Everything that's happened in Oakland for the last 4 or 5 years would have killed anybody else, broke anybody else, run anybody else crazy a long time ago after the first punch. It didn't bother us that much. Well, I'm not gonna, let me back up. When this stuff first started happening, and I'm in the early 20s, it was very serious. You've got the whole package, paranoia and everything else. But you learn about yourself. Paranoia, what you gonna do? Two responses, either fight or flight. I'll learn or I'm gonna get juiced up, but I'm ready to fight. You know, I'm still paranoid. Yeah, but there ain't no doubt about that. People on the telephone pole, that ain't no Pepco or PG&E. That's the police. Niggas down there, that's the police. You paranoid. Of course, you're 70-80% accurate. And then they fly a helicopter about, can you imagine what a helicopter sounds like 20 feet above your roof? And your house is shaking, you talking about getting juiced up. Boy, they was using psychological stuff on the brother, and all I was doing was getting mad. I'm ready to fight. I'm running out there. Come on down here, sucker. Here I am. It was great. It was good teaching. That stuff is, that was 40-something years ago. That stuff ain't nothing now. That's what I want y'all to understand. Stop looking at what we're doing the way you would look at it in those days. I am not like y'all. Y'all stopped at the first stage. You accepted the white man's authority. I've been all over the world. You gotta remember, when you read about anything, post-colonial, all the struggles, all you hear about the Netherlands now, well, I've been to all of the Netherlands and Denmark and Sweden, all of those places, and experienced them, okay? South America, how many niggas you know? Y'all watch Scarface and you think, boy, that's exciting. It is. Go down to South America, get, do you know how much intelligence it takes to get cocaine or have it produced in South America? To transport it up here, to get it up, all each stage is a miracle. And then to have it distributed in America. You can't be no dummy doing that. Now, Oakland, what did y'all say? Well, the brother's all over Africa, he's done for, it's all over. Next thing y'all hear, I'm calling people to come on down to South America and I'm sending dope back up to the best cocaine y'all ever seen. You didn't have none as good before, and you definitely ain't had none as good after, right? So, how much sense do you have? How many levels do you have to evolve to be able to do that, right? Okay, now, this revolutionary stuff. Okay. Here's the president they hate. This is one they hate more than anybody. This is Sri Lanka. Welcome, Imam Abdullah Lee Musa. Sri Lanka. Do y'all know what Sri Lanka is? No, I'm sure you don't. Used to be called Ceylon. You know the word serendipity? So that's where the word comes from Sri Lanka or Ceylon. Serendipity is so beautiful. That's Sri Lanka. Welcome Imam Abdullah Lee Musa to South Africa tour. This is a tour, 2013. Da, 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 da. It looks like I'm running for president. Tell the truth. Right? Do you think the white man likes that? Hey, man. One of the things, it was something, well, anyway, I don't have to show you all of them. This is the rock bar. This is the supreme leader. There's no other Americans you've ever seen that has a picture with him. I don't think no other Americans have ever met him. Right? You ain't never seen no picture of no American interviewer, politician, or nobody with the supreme leader. Look at this big smile. This is a big smile. They're smiling. Sudan, everybody is there. This is a big conference. You know. And, hey, bro, how's all, man? Look at here. Da 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 da. Oh, you think the white man likes that? Heck no, he don't like it. It just started. This is way back during Imam's time. It's a world conference, right? You tell Pakistan, Sudan, Palestine, who's representing America? This is at least 30 years ago. Okay, remember I was telling you about potential leaders? If they will set you up to shift you away from being just a regular, nice little potential friendly neighborhood leader, what will they do if everybody that they don't like likes you? Right? This is our friend here. Well, he's not as friendly as us, but he's still all right. Whatever it is, just use your imagination. Does the Americans like that? If they don't, what have they done to people that act like that? Okay. Now I want to mention a few people you can remember. Remember H.R.A.P. Brown? H.R.A.P. Brown, that's who he is. He's in them. That's H.R.A.P. Brown, Imam Jamil Al-Amin. Revolution from Egypt to the Americas. This came off the web, some stuff that they put on there to scare everybody. Oakland and the American Islamic Revolution. What does that mean? Have you seen any revolution in Oakland? Tell the truth. I'm talking to Oakland. What revolution have you seen in the last decades in Oakland, right? Well, why would they put this here, revolution of Egypt to the Americas, Oakland and the Islamic Revolution? What revolution is going on in Oakland that white folks know about that you don't know about? Why is everybody drawing guns at our masjid? Why is everybody causing maximum government foolishness in Oakland? Why? Because Oakland and the American Revolution, Islamic Revolution, us. From the old days up to now, we have never changed what we've been working toward. Not a physical revolution, but a transformation. See, the way this cracker white folks is running stuff is senseless. It don't make sense. It's unnecessary. Can you imagine? Look at all the space and homes and everything and all the food. They talk about people are starving to death in America and other parts of the world, and they pay farmers to plow under food. Did y'all know that? When did they start? That's been going on for 40 years that I know about. They'll pay a farmer to keep the prices up, right? Even during the Depression and the 30s, they would pour out milk, because if you have an abundance of stuff, it's cheap. So, what do? You plow it under and pour it out, and the government pay the farmer to plow under them beautiful crops, because then you could get 10 ears of corn for 20 cents with all that corn, right? We want to charge you $2 a year or $1 a year. We're going to put it on sale for not for no 20 cents a dozen, right? Which if they left it alone, that's what it would be. Milk, who wants milk at 20 cents a gallon? Well, all the milk they got, so they had to pour the milk out, right? They had to pour the milk out. They did it during the Depression when people were starving, they do it right now, right? They pay your tax money to people to pour out stuff, so if you want something to eat, you have to have money. If you want to live somewhere, you have to have money. Think about it. The difference between people living in houses and people living in the streets, the people in the streets does not have paper, money that they print, right? Because it's a capitalist system. Capitalism is not a functional system at all. But do you think they're going to let someone reorganize the system? War is unnecessary. Old Trump just put out a new thing. What's going to go up? The defense budget. The defense budget. To defend against who? Don't nobody want to fight America? But who makes the money? Well, they're going to send 1,000 new troops of your family. The poor folks, they're going to send niggas, Mexicans, and dumb, poor white people to fight over there. They're going to get killed. But who's going to make all the money? Military-industrial complex. All the boys that's got all the money now, they're going to make it more. You're going to pay for it. Your son, daughter's going to get killed. And when they come back here, they got the defense budget up. To train you, it costs over $1 million to put you in out there on the front line. Right? That's true. Do they spend $1 million on your behind when you get back over here? No. You dumped in the street. We're gonna hire military members. Yeah. If it's 1,000 come back, they're gonna hire at least 10 or 15 of them. The rest are gonna go crazy. How is it that they shooting themselves every day? Because they've been abused, they know the truth. We went over there and killed people that didn't have no need to be killed, and we did this and we did that, bam, and they shoot themselves in the head, and everybody keeps on, as they say, the band plays on. We're not accepting that, no siree. Mm-mm. We're not accepting that misery index. So, Imam Jamil Al-Amin, a great hero of the movement, they harassed him, and they said, he said, if they come mess with me again, I'm going to do such and such. I know he didn't say that, because he's a peaceful man. He understands how to go. But they said, and the police said, and everybody said, we didn't know we was going to arrest Jamil Al-Amin just because they had tried to set him up in 96, a few years earlier, right? And the guy went to the news, and O'Care was even there, and he said, Imam Jamil Al-Amin didn't shoot me, and nobody in his community shot me. The police told me to say that. That's what the guy said on TV. Whatever happened, everybody, if Andy Young, they ask him about it, he says, well, I send my daughter to live in their community because it's safe over there. The next question is, why don't you help them get out of penitentiary? Why don't you help say something? But we have to follow the law. And the sheriff even said, a black woman, those people helped us get where we are today. But we have to carry out the law. Well, the law always says, hang the niggas, put the niggas in the penitentiary, and if you're carrying out the law, you're carrying out a slave policy. Simple as that. That's all you're doing. But anyway, so they snared Imam Jamil. This is Imam Lukman, Detroit. Oh, come over and help us move some, I don't know, whether it was radio, TV, something, some electronic
TV.
TVs. And
if you just said something,
he went,
what it was.
Then they come and they kill him. Then they have my picture right here. They done whooped the brother, dragged me around all the time. I don't get bad. I ain't gonna, yeah, if you come do that again, I'm gonna shoot you. Why am I not gonna do that? Why do I come back here laughing? Yeah, I just got back from the jail. Boy, they drug me around over there at 6th District, handcuffed backwards, and then they got me down to jail and drug me over there, and then the guy was jumping up and down on the head downtown. I don't say, yeah, I'm mad as hell. I don't, you know why? Because I'm not. It's common. I know the price of what I say is. So if I got mad at them and wanted to fight, that would be, I'd get one shot at it. That'd be it. And you shoot some old stupid police and they got another dummy waiting right there. Please, can I go get shot for y'all, boss man? Right? So that's why I don't get mad at them about nothing. Imamuto, we got some stuff over here just for you. Well, what you got? Oh, we got some computers, and we got this, that, and another. I said, well, that's good for you. I don't want to have nothing to do with them. If you would like to give the brother $50,000, $100,000 cash, you can come and sit it right down the table in front of everybody. In case it's funny money. Mukhtar and them dumb Negroes. They use, same thing happened with Imam Jamil. Y'all ever heard of Yahweh Ben Yahweh? Big Negro. Down in Florida, they infiltrated them with open snitches. Right? I am a snitch, is what the niggas saying. And they say, that's good. Bam, bam. And they go off to the penitentiary for the rest of their life. Only reason they didn't give them the death, the gas chamber, the electric chair, because they didn't did away with that stuff in that state. So they have Mukhtar and big old Buffalo gal, Khadijah. They can come right, you can see it on, they're gonna harass me and make me mad. So I can do what? I'm Big Hank, you gotta respect me. That's what they thought. That's what I pretended. Y'all remember, I was saying here, ain't no imam, I'm the imam, and I'm da-da-da-da-da-da-da. So when I go out there, they think this nigga is mad. And so here they come. That's called engineering. We engineered that. And we engineered everything that goes along with them because we have studied revolution from day one. We have articles on it. We're studying and writing about every aspect of it because we have a job to do. What's that job? That job? First of all, what have we done? We have done what we call a historical ass-kicking of the system. Yes. A comprehensive ass-kicking. Yes. I can say that because it's not just Jumu Kutba, it's just the Negro have pulled off what we call global counter-encircling. It's not only Malta, it's Europe, Africa, Asia, this whole hemisphere, not just up here, USA, Canada, but all the way from Canada down to Argentina and Brazil, Chile right down the corner. Yeah, that's what we have produced. Why? Because when they arrested us and tried to kill us the first time in 1970, that let us know what our status was. The only problem was they left that big pretty car out here and everybody's running around. Where Big Hank at, man? Because, you know, you're very popular, everybody like you and stuff like that. They had me over at the Royal Park in the parking lot. Y'all remember where that parking lot is, the Royal Park. Same place the little pirate ship is right there, you know, the little pirate ship for kids in the big sand thing. Well, nigga, it's all over for your black, blah, blah, blah. They was really using some foul language, I'm telling you. And they was getting ready to shoot the brother. Big smiles on these crackers' face. And I used some pretty foul language, too. Like, F you crackers and all of that. And, you know, your mama's a blankety blank. All that kind of stuff. Then, beautiful sound as you ever heard. You remember them old movies where the cavalry would come riding in, blowing the bugle just before that engines finish everybody off? Here come the Negroes. There he is! There he is right there. That's where they took Big Hank and everybody. Yeah, man, there he is. I just, Mother Scrubber, maybe you're going to have to do the brother another day. Lo and behold, some traffic thing, they took me out to Greystone. Y'all remember Greystone Barracks? I'm in the, on the compound. You old timers remember this is the county jail facilities out there. They got a county farm. Remember in the old days they had a county farm? I'm out there, Officer Dillard, he black man. I'm driving a truck. In fact, I ain't gonna tell nobody. Actually, it was a hog in the back of the truck, a pig that I was driving around. Now, I was still a Muslim, but I mean it. Halal and haram, if you carry the pig, if you cut the pig, if you slice the pig, just like whiskey and stuff, it's haram. But remember in those days, so anyway, I had the big pig in the truck, so Sergeant Sansucci come from over the county jail part, Greystone. Y'all remember Greystone, all of you there. Greystone was old Japanese barracks, had all them cells. And the catwalks on top, they could walk all over and look down in there. Yeah, that's what they had to. Took the brother over there, Sergeant Sansucci. And he had his gun on. He took me over there. I'm minimum security. Why you put me in Greystone? Maximum security. Next thing I know, I'm standing there for sick call and getting a little headache, something other. And the white boy come by with a half of scissors in. And I just happened to move a little bit and the white boy missed me and the nurse is standing right there, the white nurse, and don't say nothing. I was lucky. And me and Iceman was sellers. They put Iceman, who was in the cell. Y'all remember Iceman, Carl Hope, big muscle bound Negro. Anyway, this is a famous case. I mentioned part of it to my son. I was talking about it. He said, no, this is what happened. The whole state of California knows about it. So long story short, the next day, they gonna finish off the brother. They let us out in the bullpen. The white boys got knives. And we in there, and the white boys is moving on us, and we retreated to the mop ringers and the mops. In those days, the mop ringers was made out of metal. Remember them big mop ringers? Good God Almighty. And it was two there. And here's two niggas lifting iron. Each one of us can get about 400 on the bench on the street. You know what I mean? That means the mop ringer didn't weigh, but it's like a toothbrush. So them white boys, we told them, you get close, we're going to roll wheel on you crackers. That means we're going to step in, bang, I'd go first, knock him upside the head, step over, step back, and he steps in. It's a wheel, is what you call it. But in gang warfare, you develop techniques. Everybody know they're effective too. And you crack up the first white boy upside the head with that mop ringer, and you can lift 400 pounds, he gonna be gone. If you hit him on the arm, it don't make no difference. That boy is gone. And the knives are not that big. The knives are some little old, they'll give half a scissor. So if they do stick you, it ain't gonna kill you. Even if they stick you in the heart, the thing will probably seal back up before, you know what I mean, before you go away. You know, anyway, man, everybody was watching that, and this is a famous case. Everybody know that. But this is 1970. I only had 10 days to do. So I went on out. I told my lawyer, didn't know what, nobody mad about it. Just like now. No matter what happens, you don't see nobody getting too upset about, man, they did that? Well, let's turn some flips. Don't nobody, they said, that's interesting. To today, it's the same response. So anyway, here's what we're doing. First of all, we thank Allah for allowing us to participate in the historical mission. We're trained for this mission. The isolation, the segregation, and everything else that they put on you, if you grew up in the system, Allah will prepare you for your mission, and you won't even know what you're being prepared for. But it's when it comes time for you to encounter or go through certain things, you'll be ready for it. So, what are we here today for? We're here to expose the whole counterintelligence program, the drug trade, the whole everything all over the world. We have actually lived through everything we hear on the news. You know, it's so ridiculous. Yesterday, Chuck Berry died, right? Guess what? We was in Lompoc camp together. Y'all remember when Chuck was there? He was in Lompoc in 79 and 80. And then they punished us because when he went home, he came back and part of his restitution was to sing for us. And he sang all this stuff, and it was Chuck. You know why it's Chuck? He had a brand new Broham and a white girl, nice looking white lady. That was his calling card. He never left none of them behind. You could never look to the day he died, and Chuck was smart too. On business fact, he always had his little briefcase under his arm, like he trying to figure out a way to get out. He was in the camp, man, what are you worried about? You're gonna be gone before you can figure it out. But he was always studious, and to the day he